Well, of course, artificial intelligence has been one of the big stories in 2024. Companies are investing millions of dollars right now to figure out how it can help their operations improve. And then there is the public at large. They are seeing how it can change and improve their day-to-day lives. Pleasure to talk AI in 2024, but what we can expect next year and beyond with Lynn Wu, who's an associate professor of operations, information, and decisions here at the Wharton School. Hi, Lynn. Great to see you again.
Same here.
Great to have you with us. Look, I think my first line in there kind of sets the stage for this. We've had artificial intelligence around, but it feels like this year, maybe to a degree a little bit in 2023, but this year specifically, it has just been this explosion. How have you viewed what we've seen play out around AI this year?
Well, I think this year we have seen a tremendous amount of progress on both technology and also just general adoption by the wider part of the society, like not just the tech firms, but small, medium-sized businesses are starting using AI. Big firms are developing AI strategies around their operations, marketing, and a variety of work functions. So we see definitely a wider use of adoption, also just general use.
That component of both large and small businesses using it, I think, is one of the unique aspects of it, because a lot of people would probably say, okay, larger business has the resources to be able to make the investment, but there are avenues that small businesses can really dig deep into and really benefit from.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I like to think of example, just like, you know, like search ads back in like 20 years ago. Remember? It kind of democratized advertising in some expense.
Sure, yeah.
You can think about Gen AI democratized some of the knowledge, you know, knowledge search, and also general use of for writing, for coding, for development project for players that weren't able to do this in a large scale before.
One of the areas that was talked about for a while, and I think we're seeing it, you know, play out maybe in a different path, was how it was going to impact labor. I mean, the discussion point was, well, it's going to take jobs away. It's, you know, we're going to see new dynamics at play. It feels like that it's a little bit different, that there is a complementary aspect to AI that's maybe taking a bigger role, at least right now.
Well, I think the complementarity is going to be key in the future and also in the present. There are lots of things Gen AI can do, and there are lots of things it does terribly and does it wrong. And you've seen the hallucination examples, right? And there are things they're not very good at. And I think finding that complementarity, figuring out what humans are really good at and what machines are really good at and how the machines and the human can work together on a variety of different tasks in a variety of different industries, that's going to be key. And it's not just about figuring out complementarities. Once you figured out that working relationship, you also need to redesign the workforce, the work processes around it to support that complementarities.
I think the belief by a lot of people is, or at least the expectation, is that AI will be perfect. We know that's not the case because it's still humans that are doing a lot of the behind the scenes work. So what should our expectations be around AI and its usage and its capabilities maybe going forward?
I think one good rule of thumb is that if you're already good at this, AI is going to help even more. But if you're not good at this already or have a very, very rudimentary knowledge about something, I would use AI cautiously because it does hallucinate. It will tell you things sounds very true, but in fact, it's not true. In fact, it confidently says the wrong thing. And that is where it's difficult for somebody who do not have in-depth knowledge about the field to disambiguate. Is this right or is it wrong?
So that becomes an important dynamic for businesses to have that understanding and to kind of factor that in to the operational piece of understanding that AI is going to be great, but it won't be 100%, you know, proof in terms of what it can bring to the table.
And it'll never be with the state of art today, right? It will never be for the next couple of years. So I think it's really important for all business to mitigate the risks of using these type of tools in a variety of settings.
I saw a paper that you had talked about how AI was going to impact innovation. Take us into your thoughts about where AI will play a role in that area specifically.
Yeah, I think AI is going to really change how products are being developed. I think one key thing we've discovered in our recent research is that AI really turbocharges prototyping, right? Before, you have to make an ad yourself, right? Figure out image, which actor to use. Now, these are all just generated automatically using generative AI. So you can just decide to have 10 different copies,
right?
And with whatever actor you want, and then play it out. So that rapid prototyping is going to be huge, right? And that's not just for digital products.
Right.
We also see in physical products too. AI guided prototypes, like AI gave you ideas on where you actually should build a prototype,
right?
And how you should release it in a while and collect data, creating this positive feedback loop where AI guides you to develop a product, and a product, when a consumer using the product, those data are being fed back to the machine and continuously improve your product. So that really expedited prototyping, and that can dramatically change the way product even develop in both small firms and big firms.
What do you say to the people that obviously there are some concerns out there about bad actors and what they can bring forward by using AI? And I think the question of how we mitigate some of the negatives out there becomes an important component to this as well.
I think this is huge. And for a variety of reasons, you mentioned about bad actors. I think that's where regulation could potentially be helpful. You can have a saw, right? And a saw can be used to kill somebody. A saw can also use to amazing tool to help you, you know, cut down a tree, build furniture, right? AI is just a tool, but you need to have you need to have uses on where it should be used and where it shouldn't be used. And also, I want to also caution that as firms are widely using these generative AI tools, these tools are actually very, very expensive.
Right.
Right. And it won't become cheaper anytime soon. You would generally consider, you know, the exponential growth, like, you know, Moore's Law, will continuously making technology cheaper and cheaper.
Right.
But we also see generative AI is a highly concentrated industry with a few player each level of the AI stack. So it's never going to be that cheap because of the, you know, because of concentration industry.
What about the component of AI with the general public and how it impacts their day-to-day operations of doing projects? And I know part of the conversation for me started here at Wharton with professors talking about how they were going to deal with generative AI use in their classes and with testing and such. How do you see that playing out?
Oh, you mean AI in education or AI?
Well, AI in just use with the public, I think, in general.
In general. Well, I think AI is a general purpose technology. Just think of internet, right? Internet can be used for a variety of things, variety of reasons, right? And I think for a general public, it's also the same thing, right? You should, as individuals, should try to do everything you can, you're doing, and see AI can do it,
yeah.
Right? And then see where things that AI is really good at, like, that can help you expedite the work you do, and also see where it can go astronomically wrong, right? Then that's the area you should focus on putting more time, effort into. I think this is very individual for people, also individual for firms,
yeah,
to figure out what the best use cases for you specifically is going to be. And that is going to be key to unlock the benefit of AI for you.
Well, part of that conversation is almost generational, like younger generations versus older generations, and how they accept and use AI. It feels like right now, and you can shed light on this, that a lot of generations are trying to, you know, get their feet wet and understand the impacts of generative AI. Younger generations may be able to just run with this as we go in future years and be able to use it in even, you know, even greater uses in the years ahead.
I actually think older people can use generative AI pretty well. Maybe my sample is small. I see my parents using it all the time to say, hey, this is a medical report. What does it really say?
Yeah.
Right? I think it can definitely, it's because the usage itself is relatively easy. It's a conversational bot.
Yeah.
In many, you know, that's where how most people are using it. So I actually think it lowers the typical, you know, technology requirement for older people to use.
Right.
Than you know, some other technologies out there.
Which will be great then for all generations.
Exactly. Exactly. I actually worry about young people using these tools too much.
Why so?
Well, because you don't know how to write anymore. You don't know how to...
Well, that's true too, yeah.
You don't know how to do the basic things. And you use this tool to substitute it. And I think that could be a problem.
What do you think then, going back to the component of innovation, what are the biggest challenges of incorporating AI to enhance innovation moving forward?
Oh, there's lots of challenges out there. So number one thing you really have to be aware is that all these AI-guided prototyping, all these AI-generated innovation tend to be recombinational and incremental, right? These are great innovations, right? Big 77% economic growth come from combining things in a new way, improving existing things incrementally, right? But the 13% or 19% is radically new innovation, right? And those are actually becoming more important because they immediately get fed into AI as the further enable AI to recombine that into existing technologies and improve it some new way. So I think for firms that are doing recombination incremental innovation, this is amazing, right?
Right.
You can really turbocharge it.
Well, and if you have that recombination, then from a business aspect, you're kind of taking the next step, but maybe making a different level of investment than maybe you would have if you're doing just radical innovation.
Absolutely, absolutely. But for the radical innovation people, right? So Gen AI may or may not help you. It may help you, but it's not clear. It's not that clear how to the extent it can help you.
Right.
Then what do you do, right? So I produce this amazing technology. If I release it wild, I create a lot of positive spillover to others who can use my technology to combine something in a new way or improve it better than I could.
Right.
But then what do I get out of it, right? So there's a bit of incentive change because one part of innovation, recombination and incremental got much, much cheaper.
Yeah.
Elevates actually the value of the radical innovation. And we actually need to protect that radical innovation more than before.
What do you think then 2025 means for the growth of AI?
Ooh, that's a really tough question.
Yeah.
I think it can go both ways. And let me explain that to you. So the pace of where AI technology is improving is exponential. And it's still riding an exponential curve.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? But there's also limitation that can constrain that exponential growth. Number one is that we already ran out of high fidelity data, which is, you know, the human written, you know, articles and writings. Because remember, OpenAI and others had made exclusive access to Wall Street Journals and others, right? Because we need human to write these texts.
Sure.
Right. And these data has mostly trained on internet data produced by humans.
Right.
Okay? But now these data is actually being produced by machines now. So gradually degrades the technology output because machine-generated data, when it's fed into AI algorithm, produce less good stuff than human data. So there's a limitation on data.
Right.
And also, as I mentioned before, these things are still going to be very, very expensive.
Sure.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah.
So we're going to see exponential growth and concentration, industry concentration makes it so much more expensive, then adoption will be diminished.
Right.
So you're going to see these two forces going on, like which one's going to win out. It's going to be a big one. So right. It's unclear. Yeah.
Lynn, great to see you again. Thanks very much for your time.
Mm-hmm.
Great to have you here. Lynn Wu, Associate Professor of Operations, Information, and Decisions here at the Wharton School.